Hello and welcome to this special edition of The Buck Stops Here once again from Chennai. We are in the beautiful Sacred Heart Church Park School because this is where Jayalalithaa spent some of her key formative years as a student. Her images, the memories of her time here are writ on the walls. Starting from this image, this is Jayalalithaa just graduating from the school in the 11th standard, winning the title for the best student. Here's another picture of her at an even younger age, along with the other students. And this is her visiting her alma mater on sports day to give away prizes. Remember, Jayalalithaa always said that she was a reluctant film actress and a reluctant politician because she was this outstanding student. And perhaps if fate had taken a different turn, she may have followed an entirely different path. In fact, the school has been happy to show us this shield, which has the embossings of all the toppers, all the ones who won this shield for being at the very top. And you can't quite see the inscription, but if you look at the one which is just from bottom, the first one to the left, it actually mentions Jayalalithaa, and it also has the year embossed on it. And it's a reminder of the remarkable trajectory of a remarkable politician, who of course now is gone. And what follows next is the big question. Will that legacy be protected, or are there already questions being raised about whether there will be controversies, whether there will be some sort of now proxy war within the ADMK as different factions tussle for the control of the party? That's what we're going to be debating tonight. As you can see, we have with us a wonderful panel here, next to me, as well as we have some members of the audience who represent a wide cross-section of Chennai. Now, the question that has surfaced since the time of Jayalalithaa's unfortunate death has been, who really is in charge of the ADMK and who has been calling the shots, and how was this fairly dramatic transition of power affected? It all happened very, very quickly, literally in the matter of 24 to 48 hours since the time when she had that cardiac arrest to the time when a late night swearing-in took place in Raj Bhavan. It was almost close to about midnight when the new cabinet, the new chief minister was sworn in, and just around the time her death was being formally announced. It was fairly unprecedented in the history of Indian politics for something like that to occur. And while in the aftermath, the immediate aftermath, it was praised for being conducted with such smoothness and the funeral that went off without any violence, questions are also being asked now as more information comes out as to whether due process was indeed followed. Were the norms of democracy fulfilled, or were they sabotaged inside a hospital coup? NDTV actually has some exclusive details of that. But before we break them, just to put it in context, those questions have surfaced because immediately in the aftermath of Jayalalithaa's illness and then subsequently her passing away and then at her funeral, the family or those who seemed most prominent and most active were the members of the Sasikala Natarajan family. Now, until that time, they had taken the back seat. They were always seen as being behind the scenes and operating a sort of kitchen cabinet. But now they seem to take center stage. In fact, we're putting those images up on the screen, and you can see different members of her family, Sasikala herself, as well as her nieces and nephews and brothers and so on, several of whom had actually been banned from entering Post Garden because of fears that they were using Jayalalithaa's influence to try and peddle their own influence and also financially enrich themselves. But now they were all back, and they were the ones receiving the VIPs, they were the ones who seemed to be in charge. And therefore this question as to who is the real power center in the AIADMK. Now, we spoke to a cabinet minister in the party, as well as another top source in the party, to confirm exactly what went on that night and whether or not that followed, as we said, the due norms. And this is what we learned. Let's start putting up those graphics on the screen about whether there was a midnight coup in Apollo and whether top ministers and MLAs were kept in the dark about the transfer of power. Now, what we learned is that after the cardiac arrest on Sunday evening, the ministers and MLAs were asked to come to Chennai and rush to Apollo. At about 10:40 p.m. on Sunday night, they were told that Jayalalithaa was only going to undergo a minor procedure. This included the gentleman who's now the chief minister himself, Mr. O. Paneerselvam. But that procedure actually went on till 4 a.m. And then they were told she's being taken back to the ICU. No explanation was given to them why a minor procedure lasted nearly 6 to 7 hours. When they tried to see her as she was being taken from one side to the next, they found that screens had been erected inside the Apollo second floor. This is where Jayalalithaa has been for the past 70 days, and they couldn't actually see what was going on. This, they also said to us, was the first time that something like this happened. At 11 a.m. on Monday, they were asked to gather in the basement of Apollo for a meeting of the MLAs and the ministers. At this meeting, they were made to sign three blank pages. Now, each of these pages were an A4 sheet of paper, and it had just their names and then a blank space next to it to sign, and they all signed these sheets of paper. No explanation was given to them what these sheets of paper were about or what was the purpose of the meeting. It just simply was a set of instructions given, and they followed it. No senior party officials were present to preside over it as well. Subsequently, they were asked to remain inside the hospital. At 2 p.m., several of these ministers and MLAs went back to the second floor, and then they noticed that a very large number of Sasikala's relatives, as well as those who they associated with her, were milling around, and some of them informally began to tell these ministers and MLAs that Jayalalithaa was no more. And this led to a lot of emotion, a lot of sobbing. There was confusion. They were then told to go to the party headquarters for the meeting at 6 p.m. This was actually the formally intimated meeting. Remember that many of the details we're now sharing with you were not formally confirmed to us. We'd heard that there was an informal meeting of the MLAs in the hospital, but the party denied it. The formal meeting, they told us, was at 6 p.m. at party headquarters. Now, when they actually arrived at the meeting, they found that except for the big five of the ministers, everyone else was there. So there was, of course, Mr. Paneerselvam. He was present at the he was not present at the meeting, along with three, four other key ADMK ministers, but all the others were there. There was no explanation again as to why he wasn't there and what was taking so long. Finally, it was only at about 11:15 p.m., 5 hours later, when this big five arrived. So for about 5 to 6 hours, there was nobody present there, and no other ministers and MLAs allowed to leave. There's the suspicion now that it is during this time that important negotiations were taking place between the AIADMK's top leadership and the Sasikala family inside the hospital about what would be the next step in this transition of power. This is the suspicion that at least two gentlemen from within the party, one of them, as I said, is a minister, shared with us. Now, at this point when the ministers entered, the AIADMK party chairman, Madhusudanan, who was all present during the entire time, he was inside, he was waiting with all of them. He was simply handed a one-line statement, which he read out, which simply said that Mr. O. Paneerselvam has been appointed AIADMK party leader in the assembly. At midnight, the ministers were then asked to leave their car. They said, by then, this was around midnight. The ministers were asked to leave their car at the party headquarters, and buses were organized to transport them and the MLAs to Raj Bhavan. And the rest is something that we all know what happened, that they arrived there, they were stunned to find that there were all the arrangements in place for a swearing-in. The chief secretary was there, the officials from the chief minister's office were there, and then this swearing-in took place. And then at 12:40 p.m., the hospital finally issued a release saying Jayalalithaa had passed away. Now remember, informally, they had been told at 2 p.m. that this had happened, but finally, it was only at 12:40 p.m. that the official release was released, which put the time of death at 11:30 p.m. So there was almost a gap of 9 hours, which remains unexplained. Why did it take so long to formalize it? Again, was it because to allow these negotiations and maneuverings to take place? These gentlemen told us, our sources, that they had no idea about the formal announcement, because remember, in the middle, some news channels had actually broken the news that she was no more, and the hospital had clarified, saying she's alive and she's still on life support. So they had no idea any of this had happened, and they only learned the formal announcement of her death when they were in Raj Bhavan, where once again they broke into tears. Now, like I said, some of this, there were glimmerings of this while we were reporting this story, but now, having spoken to these insiders, the entire picture becomes clear, and that raises, as I said, these questions about what actually went on, and whether this will ensure that Tamil Nadu actually gets a government which is representative, rather than being one which is run by a remote control. Joining me to debate that, I have a very special panel here with me in the studio, and also here at the school venue. I'm joined by Mr. N. Ram, who's a senior, of course, a journalist and part of the Hindu group. He's also an alumni of the school, I'm told. So
yes,
thank
for
you.
For some months, yes.
For some months. And joining me is Jayanti Natarajan, who is once, of course, known prominently as a Congress leader, but she's here as an independent voice, also a school alumni.
Absolutely.
Manu Sundaram of the DMK joins me here at the venue as well. We just want to make it clear, by the way, that the school is simply a setting for this discussion and they have really no other role to play. It's just because of the history associated with it that we chose the school. Also joining us on the OB, on the VSAT, is Khushbu Sundar of the Congress. And also joining us is Mr. Narayanan of the BJP, Mylapore Narayanan, as well as Mr. Kalyani Shankar. We also hope to have an ADMK representative with us very shortly, and we will update you the moment that takes place. But first, if I can just, Mr. Ram, get you to comment on some of these details which we've just released, and I know that some of these aspects of it have been reported as well in the past, but now we have a fairly clear picture of how this entire transfer of power was affected. Is it a cause for concern?
Yes, it is certainly a cause for concern. Once all this is validated and
yes,
it becomes irrefutable,
yes,
it certainly shows that something that shouldn't have happened had happened.
Yes.
Although, as you say, we are praising or everyone is surprised by the ease of the transition, the smoothness of the transition.
Yes.
The concern it raises really is about what is about to unfold.
Hmm.
Whether this deal, as you depicted it,
yes,
involves any extra constitutional play. Now, obviously, the family being there, because you remember that Sasikala had said they are persona non grata, they suddenly overnight
yes
became persona grata, particularly when the body was lying in state at Rajaji Hall.
I think that's what actually led to these questions being asked. But amongst the various details that we put out, and like you said, we still have to see how much further we can validate it and sort of strengthen the evidence that's there, but these are fairly reliable sources. But amongst the details that we put out, one of the things that I found most disturbing was this aspect of getting MLAs to sign on three blank
yes
forms.
Yes.
You know, obviously, this was done to show that there was some yes sort of legislative party meeting held, which would endorse the candidature of Paniselvam later in the evening. But what else they were signing for is unclear.
Yes, I think there have been precedents for this, and it's very unfortunate
yeah
that in Tamil Nadu and possibly some other states, people who have no choice,
yes,
people who are enthralled
yes
to someone else, the leaders, some fear, are asked to sign like a blank check.
Yes.
You're signing away your life, your career, in effect, unless it's proved invalid in a court of law. The governor would have required it. And once this is validated, it
yes
would certainly, invalidate the whole process. Although he's now chief minister, but the question, the deeper question is,
yes,
what kind of role would this family play? They had no sanction from Jayalalithaa. Jayalalithaa made it very clear
yes
as chief minister that Sasikala has nothing to do with this government. In fact, she told me in 2009, if my mother had been alive, she would
yes
have looked after me. My mother is not alive, so my sister is looking after me. Of course, Sasikala was a party member,
okay,
an ordinary member, twice expelled, taken back on the condition. She apologized on the condition
for not,
not bring any of these guys.
People, and I'll come back to all of you in just a second. But I also now have with me Dr. V. Maitreyan, AIADMK spokesperson, who's agreed to participate on the program on the condition that it's not going to be part of the debate, but it will just be simply on a one-on-one interview. Thank you so much, Dr. Maitreyan, for joining us. You know, more and more details emerging, sir, of how this entire transition was affected, and it doesn't entirely paint this process in a very good light. Like we were saying, at the first instance, it seemed like it was very smoothly affected with a great amount of efficiency and without any violence. But now it appears that there are serious question marks, including holding meetings of MLAs without clearly informing them what was going on, making them sign documents without telling them what was going on. How would you explain this, sir?
Srinivasan, please understand, we, the foot soldiers of AIADMK, we have still not come to terms with the hard reality that our amma is no more and she has indeed passed away. In fact,
yes,
for crores of ADMK cadre, like MGR, amma is also a living legend. And we respect her and adore her, and she lives in our heart, mind and deed. And it pains me a lot when an anchor from a channel or channels rather sitting in Mumbai or Delhi or other places You discuss this debate
yes.
impassionately, but we have passions, we have emotions. We are still in the mourning period. And to raise such, incorrigible accusations, it goes beyond our imagination. You talk of so many things. I will break one by one. You said that the MLA's meeting was held on the fifth morning in the hospital. I was there right through in the yes. Apollo Hospital on Sunday evening when Madam had the first cardiac arrest from practically from maybe from 8:39 till morning 6 a.m. I was there. Again, from I came home briefly to have a change and freshen up. I went back again by 10 o'clock and I was there till the end. No such meeting of MLAs to discuss about future and other things happened. That is number one. Number two, you said that about...
They said the meeting was not to discuss the future. It was just a meeting. Sir, I'm saying that there was no. The meeting was not to discuss any future agenda.
Yes.
What we were told is the meeting was simply called to get them to sign three blank sheets of paper with their signatures. And this took place in the conference room,
what, again,
which is in the basement of Apollo.
Again, I'm saying, see, let me explain. For example, when Madam had a serious heart attack, again, you said that some minor procedure was done. In fact, probably non-medical people may talk like that. I am a medical person. I know. See, she had a cardiac arrest.
No, what I said was, this is what the leaders... Sorry, sir, just to clarify.
One is what we call it. No, let me finish. Let me finish. Please allow me to talk.
This is what the AIADMK, MLAs and ministers were told that it's a minor procedure. I didn't say that.
No, see...
Yes.
That is what, again, I'm saying. A lay person, a non-medical person may talk like that. But you know... When she had a cardiac arrest and she had the other pre-existing problems, when a sudden arrest has happened, you have to have two procedures. One is what we call as a LVAD, left ventricular assisted device. And the second thing is what we call as an ECMO machine. For that, for fixing this ECMO machine, you have to have a sternotomy. The sternum, which is the bone in front of your chest, that has to be opened. That means it's something like a mini thoracotomy. So it takes a couple of hours. You have to open that, do the procedure, and then close the sternum. So it is not a minor procedure at all, and it takes at least a few hours. So
exactly.
Whoever is alleged to have told you, is far from truth. So that takes a couple of hours. So it may take 2 hours,
no, but
3 hours.
That's the whole point. They're saying that they were misinformed.
You face. Number one. Number three.
Dr. Methian, they say that they were misinformed. They were misinformed that it's a minor procedure, while in fact it wasn't.
No, no. See, for example, that is again what I'm saying. You please name the person who said like that and then I will fix it. Because I was there. I was never told that it is a minor procedure. Other MLAs and MPs and our ministers were there. None of us were told that it is a minor procedure. We were very clearly told that madam has gone into she has been wheeled into the operation theater and she has to have a surgery. And that it is going to be an ECMO machine which has to be filled. Anybody familiar with the medical practice
knows
what an ECMO machine is and how it has to be fixed and all those things. And then you talked, third point I want to review. You said about the coup, about the selection. See, Mr. O. Paneerselvam is a trusted aide of Madam. He has, Madam has nominated him as the interim chief minister, not once, twice. So, his being appointed for a third term as in the full-fledged capacity is a real routine formality. So that is the, to call that OPS appointment as the CM is a coup is something which I think it is blasphemous.
Can I just pin you down on the specifics of some of the information that we have? One of which, as I'm asking you, is that are you denying the fact that a meeting took place at 11 a.m. at the basement of Apollo, where MLAs and ministers were made to sign blank sheets of paper?
I deny it.
Three blank sheets of paper.
I deny it.
You deny that. Okay, could you then also explain to us, sir, why is it that a meeting...
Yes.
Okay, fine, sir, you deny it. Can I ask you, why is it then that a meeting
I'll tell you. 4:30...
What was the reason for that delay?
Yeah, I'll tell you. 4:30... I'll tell you. The 4:30, the doctors, four doctors from AIMS came. They did the last minute efforts and more or less at that point of time it looked that we are fighting a losing game. So in that situation, Normally, as a, you see, ADMK is a party of abundant precautions. So they had called for a formal meeting of the MLAs in the party office. So, but then 5:30, 5:45, madam was still on the support, life support, and obviously, before a vacancy arises, you cannot hold a meeting. Obviously, you understand that. So, unless the eventuality happens and then the announcement is made officially by the hospital, you can't have a meeting. So, when they having gone there for a meeting, they stayed back there. Once the announcement was made, they formally met there, unanimously ratified that O. Paneerselvam, who was twice Madam's nominee, he was repeated for a third term. So, I don't think there is anything really
dramatic. When you say unanimously ratified,
and it really pains us
when you make such baseless allegations
on some hearsays.
No, no, sir, these aren't, this is not baseless allegations. Trust me, we are
if you say somebody else, which is why you're talking to us, we are saying this
with all seriousness. And when you say that it was done with due consultation, what we were told is that the seniors arrived at about 11:30 at night and simply handed the president of the party a resolution to read out. The MLAs had no idea till then what this was about. They were virtually there hostage for 5 hours.
See, that is what again I'm saying. You know, you probably, you people do not know the system of AIADMK. Our party runs on loyalty. Our party runs on true obedience and discipline. And obviously, when OPS is going to be the CM nominee, I don't think there is going to be any discussion or all sorts of things. Simply, I mean, it is announced because twice, see, he is not a non-entity. He was nominated twice by Madam herself as an interim chief minister. So, automatically, it's a formality they had completed after the announcement of the sad demise of Amma. So you basically deny all of a hell of a time to discuss.
Okay, so you deny everything then?
You're denying the fact that these blank sheets were signed, nothing like that.
You're denying the fact that some of them were informed at 2 p.m.
No, as
that,
I say,
Ms. Jayalalithaa was
say,
no more.
No, no. As
and
I,
then you're denying the
I
fact
say,
that the MLAs see, were waiting there while these power, see, while these negotiations were going on.
No, I'm not denying that the MLAs were waiting. As I said, 6 o'clock or 6:37, they would have gone to the party office. But they had stayed back there when the till the announcement was made. After the announcement was made, this decision was announced. See, another thing, as I said, if you talk about some other nominee being appointed, then all these things can think. Then OPS means I don't think there is really any question. Because twice he was nominated
Sir,
by Madam Herschel,
trusted
and aid of Madam.
Doesn't it strike you as odd, sir,
as
that
what?
In just a matter of these few hours, everything was so well organized that they go to the party office, when they from there are buses to take them to Raj Bhavan. From Raj Bhavan, everyone is waiting for the swearing in. The swearing in takes place at the middle of the night.
That is the sequence.
I put it to you.
As I said, that is the, why you are talking about middle of the night.
What was the need to do it?
Did Rajiv Gandhi swear in?
Yes.
No, that's what again I'm saying. When Mrs. Gandhi was assassinated, Rajiv Gandhi, he flew from Bhubaneswar or some other place, and he, as soon as he landed in Delhi airport, he went straight and he was sworn in there. So, I mean, I don't think these are all any valid arguments.